about my DJ skills.
Dad, yo, those are mad DJ skills. Hey, UCI Irvine.
Bubba Bass, how low can you go?
The opinions and views expressed in this program do not reflect those of KUCI, its management, or the UC Board of Regents. To find out more about this talk show or other talk shows broadcasting on KUCI, log on to our website at kuci.org or check out the latest program guide.
Okay, this is DJ Ashton Marcus. I'm at the back of the On Location at the Ernest Borgnine Theater, and I'm with
Tim Cable.
So, Tim, how's the performance?
I thought it was very good. It gets better each time we do it, mm-hmm. like most plays do, and mm-hmm. there's a lot of energy. Mm-hmm. All the cast members are putting 110% in. I think it's going very well.
Great, great. Okay, and actually, you have quite a theater background yourself.
Yes, I do. I've been in several plays, mostly musical plays, starting at about year 2002 when I retired from the police department and got involved in musical theater. And I've been in several plays up until now.
Right. Which ones were they?
I'm sorry?
Which ones were they?
Which ones?
Which ones were they?
Well, let's see. I was Tevye and Fiddle of the Roof, my last production. I was Henry Higgins in My Fair Lady. I was Horace Vandergilt in Hello, Dolly. I was King Richard in Camelot, Curly in Oklahoma, and some others.
Wow, those are actually pretty impressive roles. I mean, those are pretty major productions you were in.
Yeah, they were, and I enjoyed every minute of it. With community theater, more people in the community ought to get involved in this. It's a great place to have fun learn and meet a bunch of new people and perform in front of an audience.
Great. Okay, well, let's get you on your way. Thank you very much for the interview.
Thank you.
Okay. Here's a clip from The Christmas Carol.
touch with you. Or ask me who I was.
Who are you then?
In life, I was your part, Jacob.
Okay, can you sit down?
I can.
Don't do it.
You don't believe in me.
I do not.
What evidence would you have of my reality beyond that of your senses?
I don't know.
Why do you doubt your senses?
Because little things affect them. A slight disorder of the stomach makes them cheap. You may be a bit of undigested beef, or a mustard, a crumb of cheese, or a fragment of an underdone potato. There's no more gravy than a grave of you. Why do you trouble me?
There in the worldly line, do you believe in me or not?
I do. I must. But why do spirits walk here? Why do they come to me?
It's required of every man that the spirit within him should walk abroad with his fellow man and travel far and wide. And if that spirit does not go forth in life, it is condemned to do so after death. It is doomed to wander the world as a pariah and witness things it cannot share, but might have shared in life, on earth, and change to happiness.
Well, you are fair. Tell me why.
I wear these chains I forged in life. I made them link by link and yard by yard. I girded it of my own free will, and of my own free will I wore. Does this pattern seem strange to you? Or do you recognize the length and width of the strong coil you bear yourself? Oh, it is a ponderous chain, and it was ponderous 7 years ago. How it is that I appear before you, I won't tell. However, 7 Christmas Eves ago, it was full and heavy. I cannot rest. I cannot linger. I cannot wait anywhere. Oh, in life, my spirit never roamed beyond our counting house. In life, my spirit never roamed beyond the narrow limits of our money-changing. But, Ebenezer, I have always, always sat invisible beside you.
Always beside me?
I have come to now to warn you that you have a hope and chance of escaping my fate. A hope and chance of my opportunity.
You were always a good friend to me, Dick Martin. Thank you.
You will be haunted by three spirits.
I think I'd rather not.
Without their visits, you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first tomorrow when you hear the voices of cherubs.
Well, couldn't that take a moment once to shake them and have it over with?
Expect the second upon the next night when you hear the same choir. The third comes on the next night when the clock strikes 12 and all mortal flesh is silent. You will see me no more. And pray that, for your sake, you remember what has gone on before us.
Possible as it could happen to the sound? I didn't all this sickness in a dream. Oh! Are you the spirit that was foretold to come to me?
I am she.
Well, who and what are you?
I am the ghost of Christmas past.
Long past?
Hey, just so past. Your welfare and your probation are at hand. Take heed. Walk with me. Now.
Hello, this is DJ Ashton Marcus, and I'm backstage at the Ernest Borgnine Theater with...
Dominic Johnson.
Oh, Dominic. So basically, how was the performance?
I thought it went really well. Obviously, a lot of nerves, because it's always rough performing in front of an audience, but I feel like we did really well today.
Great. Do you have a theater background?
I do. I've actually been performing for about 6 years. I started off in high school, mostly just ensemble stuff, did a little tech work here and there, and then this is my first time being back on stage in almost a year, so I'm really excited to be back.
Great. And you played, you actually played Scrooge's fiancée, or?
I did, Isabel. Mm-hmm. It was a stretch for me. I don't know why, it just felt like out of my element, because I've never really played, you know, the love interest. I've always been like, oh, I'm just like a waitress here, or like, I'm going to sweep up the stage and notice me. But it was interesting for once, actually having to portray some feelings toward another person that I never really had, you know, outside of my own personal life. So it's actually not that hard when you like your co-star as a person, so they're cool people.
So do you want to get into acting? Is this your career path?
Oh, absolutely. I actually, it may sound silly, but my dream is actually to be the first African-American Elle Woods in Legally Blonde on Broadway. And I'm pretty excited about it. I just got to get there. You know, a lot of training goes into that. So.
Okay, well, will we be seeing you in anything up in the future?
Actually, I'm going to be in a performance, a touring performance at the school. It's called Center of the Universe with the Phantom Theater Projects. They're based in La Mirada, and then they have auditions for The Outsiders coming up soon. Hopefully, I'll be auditioning and being cast in that as well. So if your school is interested, go ahead and call Phantom Theater Projects, and they can hook you up. It's pretty cool.
Great. Thank you very much for being on the show.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Okay, this is DJ Ashton Marcus, and I'm at backstage at the Ernest Borgnine Theater, and I'm with...
Dallas Smolson. I'm Hope in the production, also Isabel's child, and a caroler.
Ah, yeah, you're actually a pretty young person here. Do you have much experience in musical theater?
No, I do not, but I have a bunch of experience in the acting industry. I've been doing it since 2012. So for the past 2 years, I enjoy doing all this stuff, though. I'm trying to learn more about theater and what to do, so.
Yeah, I don't know a whole lot about that. How did you get into it? Did your parents encourage you, or did you go to a casting call or something?
Well, I've like watching TV, and it seems really interesting, so I just decided to try it. I got training from this girl named Tamara. I don't know her last name, but she was getting me into it, and I went to this industry called iPop, where there's over 1,000 agents, and it was really expensive to get in, so my grandma helped, and I also used the website GoFundMe, and I got a bunch of help from other people that went on that website.
Well, that's very interesting. For a kid, I wouldn't imagine you'd have the initiative to do all that. Most kids are just sitting in front of the TV watching Scooby-Doo or something.
Yeah. Well, it's actually harder than people really think it is. It's really hard to, like, try to do scenes or do other stuff on TV. It's really hard to get auditions. Some agents just want people for their looks or just their hair or something. Some people just like their hands. So they usually just look at what you do or what they want someone to do at an audition.
I've met a few people who actually do this. They go to interviews a lot, and basically they get turned down a lot, but they just keep going in there. Their parents just push them to do that. What's your experience like? Are your parents supportive of you?
My mom is very supportive, and my grandma. They both have gone through this with me. They've taken me to auditions. I've only missed one because I had an emergency. I sprained my ankle. I've only missed one. I love going to auditions. I really love meeting other agents and managers. It's really fun.
So you really think you're going to get into this in the future? I mean, are you going to study this at college?
Probably I am. I just really love doing all of this. Mm-hmm. It's really cool just to see, like, all the cameras and have, like, all these people watching you. Yeah.
Do you have anything lined up in the future that you'll be doing?
I actually want to start doing singing lessons and dancing lessons. That's really kind of what I want to start doing more.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for being on the show. I'm backstage at the Ernest Borgnine Theater, and I'm with
Ray Buffer. I'm the director of this production. Also, I guess you'd consider me the adapter, the writer of the rewriter of Dickens, where we intermesh carols into his original prose. I'm also the co-executive producer of Art in Relation, which is a new company we founded in Long Beach this year, with our first production being Frankenstein the Musical in October. This is now our second production here at the Ernest Borgnine Theater.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So how's the performance?
I'm proud of the cast. You know, when Jonah Sills, my partner, and I envisioned doing this show in this time slot, we knew it would be a show by families for families. And that's what we wanted to bring to the community. And I think that as we ingratiate ourselves as a new entity for people to come and enjoy our performances here, that we will bring those families in to see us and hopefully keep them with us into our next season.
Yeah, I see that you've actually been doing a lot of stuff this year.
Well, we plan to do a lot of stuff next year. In 2015, we've got a benefit in February called Fresh Air, where we're going to bring Broadway-caliber talent, a jazz trio, and a nice pasta dinner all together in one space to try and raise money for Art in Relation, as well as the Long Beach Scottish Rite Childhood Language Center, which is the charitable organization that the Scottish Rite supports. So they do a lot of remedial reading skill training here for families in this very building that we're in. So we want to have a portion of the proceeds go to them. We also want to help build a foundation for the season that we do have planned in 2015, which includes, after the benefit, a run of Forever Plaid in April, a one-night, or actually a one-day-only performance of the Center Stage Opera's Carmen here on June 20th at 2 p.m., and then in August, a run of Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, followed by a run of Chess the Musical in October of 2015. So it's a diversified, interesting slate of programs that we're going to bring here to the Ernest Borgnine Theater, to the Scottish Rite Theater.
Yeah, I see from your bio that you have a lot of experience in management stage, in either general managing or in marketing.
Yeah, I mean, I think I've pretty much worked every position out there in my younger days in Florida. You know, when I went to college at Florida Atlantic University, we did the required college productions. But then out of college, you know, I did some musical theater. I actually was equity for a while. And I was working fairly regularly in Florida, be it at theme parks or at theaters, dinner theaters, and other types of entertainment attractions. When I moved out here in 1999 to California, I had to kind of start over because I didn't know people. I didn't know the realm of entertainment here. So I started actually in TV and film, and I became SAG, and I did TV programs, commercials, movies for a couple of years, and then I flip-flopped when things got dry back into retail so I could get a regular paycheck. Then I flip-flopped back into theater. When I flip-flopped back into theater back in 2004, I decided I wanted to try the management side of things in terms of a professional paying job. So I actually started in marketing and worked in marketing and development for the Laguna Playhouse for a couple of years. And then I moved over to the Long Beach Opera here in Long Beach and worked for Andreas Mitasek as his general manager for about a year. And during that year, I fell in love with a theater in San Pedro called the Warner Grand Theater, which is a magnificent 1930s Art Deco theater with about 1,500 seats, and they had very little programming at the time. So while I was at the Long Beach Opera, I started to kind of build the seed of the Relevant Stage, which was my production company in San Pedro for about 4 or 5 years. When the funding ran dry back in 2011, I flip-flopped back into retail, got that regular weekly paycheck, and took a break from the arts. And then Jonas and I started talking about, you know, new endeavors, new production companies, building something here in our backyard, which for both of us is Long Beach. And we lucked upon the Scottish Rite, saw, again, an opportunity where there was very little programming, and we stepped in and said, hey, we can start something here. If you will join us, we will try to build something, and hopefully they will come. So that's where we're at.
Well, which one do you prefer more? Do you like the acting side, or do you like the backstage side?
I can't say I like one better than the other. I mean, again, I mentioned the word flip-flopping, and I think that's just because I'm a right and a left-brain person. So sometimes I enjoy the management, the analytical. Sometimes I enjoy the artistic, the performing. And when I've had enough of one, I focus more on the other. So I think I'm balanced, but who knows where my balance is at any given time. I mean, right now, this show was a nice break because Frankenstein the Musical, which was our first production, I directed it, produced it, as well as I guess starred in it because I was the creature. And so the stress of having come to rehearsal, knowing I need to direct a full cast of people, but also have a God's eye view of what's going on out there and be on stage at the same time, was very stressful. And going into the Christmas Carol, it was such a relief. I actually had to remind myself when I drove to rehearsal, I don't have lines to remember. I don't have to be on stage. I just have to tell people what to do. And even though that in some ways can be harder, it was a relief. I didn't have to perform. And so this was my holiday break, I guess. Going into the benefit, I'm not sure what my role will be, if I'll be directing. But I know it's a one-night-only event, and so it won't require the rehearsal time that a full production is required. Going into Forever Plaid, probably it'll be another case where I'm doing double duty. Maybe not directing, but I probably will be in it, and I'll probably produce it and have more to do behind the scenes. So every show will have a different dynamic as far as what I will be focusing on.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for being on the show.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Thank you for being here.
The Christmas Carol will be playing at the Ernest Borgnine Theater from December 19th to 26th. For more information, go to Art in Relation. That's all one word, artinrelation.com. Up next, we have Rosemary Barlow performing A Christmas Carol. Notice the A. A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens.
But he reeled and sank into a heavy, deep sleep. Awaking in the middle of a prodigiously tough snore, and sitting up in bed to get his thoughts together, Scrooge felt that he was restored to consciousness in the right nick of time, for he lay upon his bed, the very core and centre of a blaze of ruddy light which streamed upon it, and which, being only light, was more alarming than a dozen ghosts. He began to think that the source and secret of this ruddy light might be in the adjoining room, from whence it seemed to shine. He got up softly and shuffled in his slippers to the door. The moment Scrooge's hand was on the lock, a strange voice called him by name and bade him enter. He obeyed. It was his own room. There was no doubt about that, but it had undergone a surprising transformation. The walls and ceiling were so hung with living greens that it looked a perfect grove, from every part of which bright, gleaming berries glistened, and the crisp leaves of mistletoe, holly, and ivy reflected back the night, and such a mighty blaze went roaring up the chimney as that dull petrification of a hearth had never known in Scrooge's time or Marley's. Heaped up on the floor to form a kind of throne were turkeys, geese, game, great joints of meat, long wreaths of sausages, mince pies, plum puddings, apples, juicy oranges, and seething bowls of punch that made the chamber dim with their delicious steam. In easy state upon this couch, there sat a jolly giant, glorious to see, who bore a glowing torch and held it up to shed its light on Scrooge as he came peeking round the door. "I am the ghost of Christmas present," said the spirit. "Look upon me." Scrooge reverently did so. It was clothed in one simple green robe bordered with white fur. On its head there were no other covering than a holly wreath, set here and there with shining icicles. Its dark brown curls were long and free, free as its cheery voice and its joyful air. "You have never seen the like of me before," exclaimed the spirit. "Spirit," said Scrooge submissively, "conduct me where you will." "Touch my robe," said the spirit. Scrooge did as he was told and held it fast. All vanished instantly, and they stood in the city streets on Christmas morning. Soon the steeples called good people all to the church and chapel, and away they came flocking through the streets in their best clothes and with the gayest faces. It was a remarkable quality of the ghost that, notwithstanding his gigantic size, he could accommodate himself to any place with ease, and that he stood beneath a low roof quite as gracefully as it was possible to have done in any lofty hall. It was in his own kind, generous, hearty nature, and his sympathy with all poor men that led him straight to Scrooge's clerk. For there he went, and Scrooge with him, holding to his robe, and on the threshold of the door. The spirit smiled and stopped to bless Bob Cratchit's dwelling with the sprinklings of his torch. "Is there a peculiar flavour in which you sprinkle from your torch?" asked Scrooge. "There is," said the spirit. "Does it apply to anybody on this day?" asked Scrooge. "To any kindly given, to a poor one most." "Why to a poor one most?" asked Scrooge. "Because he needs it most." Then up rose Mrs. Cratchit, Bob's wife, dressed out but poorly in a twice-turned gown, assisted by Belinda Cratchit, second of her daughters, also brave in ribbons. And now two smaller Cratchits, boy and girl, came tearing in, screaming that outside they had smelt the goose and known it for their own, and basking in luxurious thoughts of sage and onions, these young Cratchits danced about the table, while exalted Mr. Peter Cratchit, with the corners of his monstrous shirt collar, Bob's private property conferred upon his son and heir in honour of the day, nearly choking him, blew the fire until the slow potatoes bubbling up knocked loudly at the saucepan lid to be let out and peeled. "Here's Martha, mother," cried the two young Cratchits. "Why, bless your heart alive, my dear, how late you are," said Mrs. Cratchit, kissing her daughter and taking off her shawl and bonnet with officious zeal. In came Bob, the father, with at least 3 feet of comforter, exclusive of the fringe hanging down before him, and his threadbare clothes darned up and brushed to look seasonable, and Tiny Tim upon his shoulder. Alas for Tiny Tim, he bore a little crutch, and had his limbs supported by an iron frame. "And how did little Tim behave?" asked Mrs. Cratchit, after Bob had hugged his daughter to his heart's content. "As good as gold," said Bob, "and better. Somehow he gets thoughtful, sitting by himself so much, and thinks the strangest things you ever heard. He told me, coming home, that he hoped the people saw him in the church, because he was a cripple, and it might be pleasant to them to remember upon Christmas Day who made lame beggars walk and blind men see." Bob's voice was tremulous when he told him this, and trembled more when he said that Tiny Tim was growing strong and hearty. His active little crutch was heard upon his floor, and back came Tiny Tim before another word was spoken, Bob turning up his cuffs as if, poor fellow, they were capable of being made more shabby, compounded by some hot mixture in a jug with lemons, and stirred it round and round and put it on the hob to simmer. Master Peter and the two ubiquitous younger Cratchits went to fetch the goose, with which they soon returned in high procession. Such a bustle ensued that you might have thought a goose was the rarest of all birds. The two young Cratchits set chairs for everybody, not forgetting themselves, and at last the dishes were set, and grace was said. There never was such a goose. Its tenderness and flavour, size and cheapness were the themes of universal admiration. Everyone had enough, and the youngest Cratchits in particular were steeped in sage and onions to the eyebrows. But now the plates being changed by Miss Belinda, Mrs. Cratchit left the room to take the pudding up and bring it in. In half a minute Mrs. Cratchit entered, flushed and smiling proudly, with the pudding, like a speckled cannonball blazing in half of a quartern of ignited brandy, and belight with Christmas holly stuck into the top. "Oh, a wonderful pudding," Bob Cratchit said, and he regarded it as the greatest success achieved by Mrs. Cratchit since their marriage. At last the dinner was all done, the cloth was cleared, the hearth swept up, and the fire made up, the compound in the jug being tasted and considered perfect. Apples and oranges were put upon the table, and a shovelful of chestnuts put upon the fire. Then all the Cratchit family drew round the hearth, and at Bob's elbow stood the family display of glass, two tumblers, and a custard cup without a handle. Then Bob proposed, "A Merry Christmas to us all, my dears. God bless us," which all the family re-echoed.
"God bless us, everyone," said Tiny Tim, last of all.
He sat very close to his father's side upon his little stool. Bob held his withered little hand in his, as if he loved the child and wished to keep him by his side, and dreaded that he might be taken from him.
"Spirit," said Scrooge with an interest he had never felt before,
"tell me if Tiny Tim will live."
"I see a vacant seat," replied the ghost, "in the poor chimney corner, and a crutch without an owner, carefully preserved. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die."
"No, no," said Scrooge.
"Spirit, say he will be spared. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future," returned the ghost, "no one will find him here."
"What then? If he be like to die, he had better do it, and decrease the surplus population."
Scrooge hung his head to hear his own words quoted by the spirit, and bent before the ghost's rebuke.
All the time, the chestnuts and the jug went round and round, and by there was a song about a lost child travelling in the snow, from Tiny Tim, who had a plaintive little voice, and sang it very well indeed. There was nothing of high mark in this. They were not a handsome family, they were not well-dressed, and the clothes might have known the inside of pawnbrokers, but they were happy, grateful, pleased with one another, and contented with the time. And when they faded and looked happier yet in the bright sprinklings of the spirit's torch at parting, Scrooge had his eye upon them, and especially on Tiny Tim until the last.
And now, without a word of warning from the ghost, it was a great surprise to Scrooge to hear a hearty laugh. It was a much greater surprise to recognize it as his own nephew's, and to find himself in a bright, dry, gleaming room, with the spirit standing smiling by his side.
"Ha, ha, ha," laughed Scrooge's nephew. "Ha, ha, he said that Christmas was a humbug, and he believed it too. He's a comical old fellow, and not so pleasant as he might be. However, his offences carry their own punishment, and I have nothing to say against him."
"I have no patience with him," observed Scrooge's niece, and all the others expressed the same opinion.
"I was only going to say," said Scrooge's nephew, "that he may rail at Christmas till he dies, but he can't help thinking better of it. I defy him, if he finds me going there in good temper, year after year, and saying, 'Uncle Scrooge, how are you?' So here is a glass of mulled wine ready to our hand at the moment, and I say, a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to the old man, wherever he is." And Scrooge's nephew laughed in this way. Scrooge's niece laughed as heartily as he, and their assembled friends, being not a bit behindhind, roared out lustily, "Uncle Scrooge!" Uncle Scrooge has imperceptibly become so gay and light of heart that he would have pledged the unconscious company in return if the ghost had given him time. But the whole scene passed off in the breath of the last words spoken by his nephew, and he and the spirit were once again upon their travels. Much they saw, and far they went, but always with a happy end. The spirit stood beside sick beds, and they were cheerful. In almshouse, hospital, and jail, he left his blessing, and taught Scrooge his precepts. It was a long night. It was strange, too, but while Scrooge remained unaltered in his outward form, the ghost grew clearly older. Scrooge observed this change, and as the spirit stood in an open place, he noticed that his hair was grey.
"Are spirits' lives so short?" asked Scrooge.
"My life upon this globe is very brief," replied the ghost. "It ends to-night. Hark! The time is drawing near."
The chimes were ringing in the 11:45 at that period.
"Forgive me in what I ask," said Scrooge, looking intently at the spirit's robe, "but I see something strange, and not belonging to yourself. Your robe."
From the folding of the spirit's robe it brought two children, wretched, abject, frightful.
miserable. They knelt down at its feet and clung upon the outside of its garment. Spirit, are they yours? Scrooge could say no more. They are man's, said the spirit, looking down upon him. And they cling to me, appealing from their fathers. This boy is ignorance. This girl is want. Beware them both, and of all their degree, but most of all beware this boy. From this brow I see that written which is doom, unless the writing be erased. Have they no refuge or resources? Cried Scrooge. Are there no prisons? Said the spirit, turning on him for the last time with his own words. Are there no workhouses? The bells struck 12. Scrooge looked for the ghost and saw it not. Stave 4. As the last stroke ceased to vibrate, he remembered the prediction of old Jacob Marley, and lifting up his eyes, beheld a solemn phantom, draped and hooded, coming like a mist along the ground toward him. The phantom slowly, gravely, silently approached. When it came near him, Scrooge bent down upon his knees, for in the very air through which the spirit moved, it seemed to scatter gloom and mystery. It was shrouded in deep black garments, which concealed its head, its face, its form, and left nothing of it visible, save one outstretched hand. But for this it would have been difficult to detach its figure from the night, and separated from the darkness by which it was surrounded. He felt that it was tall and stately when it came beside him, and that its mysterious presence filled him with a solemn dread. He knew no more, for the spirit neither spoke nor moved. I am in the presence of the ghost of Christmas yet to come, said Scrooge. The spirit answered not, but pointed downward with his hand. Although well used to ghostly company by this time, Scrooge feared the silent shape so much that his legs trembled beneath him, and he found that he could hardly stand when he prepared to follow it. "Ghost of the future," he exclaimed, "I fear you more than any spectre I have seen. But as I know your purpose is to do me good, and as I hope to live to be another man from what I was, I am prepared to bear your company." "Lead on," said Scrooge. "The night is waning fast, and it is precious time to me, I know." The phantom moved away as it had come towards him. Scrooge followed in the shadow of its dress, which bore him up and carried him along. They scarcely seemed to enter the city, for the city rather seemed to spring up upon them and encompass them of its own act. But there they were, in the heart of it, on the exchange amongst the merchants, who conversed in groups, looking at their watches and so forth, as Scrooge had seen them often. Scrooge advanced to listen to their talk. "No," said a great fat man with a monstrous chin. "I don't know much about it either way. I only know he's dead." "What has he done with his money?" asked a red-faced gentleman with a nose like the gills of a turkey-cock. "I haven't heard," said the man with the large chin, yawning again. "He hasn't left it to me, that's all I know." This pleasantry was received with a general laugh. "It's likely to be a very cheap funeral, for upon my life, I don't know of anybody to go to it." Another laugh. They left the busy scene and went to an obscure part of the town where Scrooge had never penetrated before, although he knew its bad repute. The whole quarter reeked with crime, filth, and misery. Far in this den of infamous resort, there was a low-browed, beetling shop, where old iron, rags, bottles, bones, and greasy offal were brought. Sitting in among the wares was a grey-haired rascal, nearly 70 years of age. Scrooge and the phantom came into the presence of this man just as a woman with a heavy bundle slunk into the shop. But she had scarcely entered when another woman, similarly laden, came in too, and she was closely followed by a man in faded black who was no less startled by the sight of them as they had been upon recognition of each other. After a short period of blank astonishment, they all burst into a laugh. The man in faded black began to produce his plunder. It was not extensive. A seal or two, a pencil case, a pair of sleeve buttons, and a brooch of no great value were all. The second woman was next.
sheets and towels, 2 old-fashioned silver teaspoons, and a few boots. And now on to my bundle, Joe, said the first woman. Joe dragged out a large and heavy roll of some dark stuff. Bed curtains, said Joe. You don't mean to say you took them down, rings and all, with him lying there. Yes, I do, said the woman. Why not? If he wanted to keep them there after he was dead, the wicked old screw, why wasn't he natural in his lifetime? If he had been, he'd have had somebody to look after him instead of lying, gasping out his last alone, by himself. Scrooge listened to this dialogue in horror. It was as though they were obscene demons, marketing the corpse itself. Spirit, said Scrooge, shuddering from head to foot. I see. The case of this unhappy man might be my own. My life tends that way now. Merciful heavens! What is this? He recoiled in terror, for the scene had changed, and he almost touched a bed, a bare, uncurtained bed, on which, beneath a ragged sheet, there lay something covered up, which, though it was dumb, announced itself in awful language. A pale light fell straight upon the bed, and on it, plundered and bereft, unwatched, unwept, uncared for, was the body of this man. Spirit! Scrooge cried. This is a fearful place. In leaving it, I shall not leave it less, and trust me, let us go. The ghost conducted him through several streets familiar to his feet. They entered poor Bob Cratchit's house, the dwelling he had visited before, and found the mother and children seated around the fire, quiet, very quiet. The noisy little Cratchits were as still as statues, and sat looking up at Peter, who had a book before him. The mother and her daughters were engaged in sewing. And he took a child and set him in the midst of them. Where had Scrooge heard those words? He had not dreamed them. The boy must have read them out as he and the spirit crossed the threshold. The mother laid her work on the table. Your father will be coming home. It must be near his time. Pass it, rather, Peter answered, shutting up his book. But I think he walks a little slower than he used to these last few evenings, mother. They were very quiet again. At last she said, and in a steady, cheerful voice that only faltered once, I have known him walk with Tiny Tim upon his shoulder very fast indeed. But he was very light to carry, she resumed, intent upon her work. And his father loved him so that it was no trouble. And there is your father at the door. She hurried out to meet him, and Bob in his comforter came in. His tea was ready for him on the hob, and they all tried. Who should help him to it most? You went there today, Robert? Asked his wife. Yes, my dear, returned Bob. I wish you could have gone. It would have done you good to see how green a place it is. But you'll see it often. I promised him I would walk there on a Sunday. My little child, cried Bob. My little child. He broke down all at once. He couldn't help it. If he could have helped it, he and his child would have been farther apart, perhaps, than they were. Poor Bob thought a little and composed himself. He kissed his wife. He was reconciled to what had happened, and he talked on as if he were quite happy. They all drew about the fire and talked, the girls and the mother working still. Bob told him of the extraordinary kindness that Mr. Scrooge's nephew, who, meeting him in the street that day and seeing that he looked a little down, you know, said Bob, inquired what had happened to distress him. On which, said Bob, for he is the pleasantest speaking gentleman, I told him, I am heartily sorry for it, Mr. Cratchit, he said, and heartily sorry for your good wife. I'm sure he's a good soul, said Mrs. Cratchit. You would be sure of it, my dear, returned Bob, if you saw and spoke to him. Spirit of Tiny Tim, the childish essence was from God. Spectre, said Scrooge. Something informs me that our parting moment is at hand. I know it, but I know not how. Tell me what man that was whom he saw lying dead. The ghost of Christmas yet to come conveyed him as before until they reached an iron gate, a churchyard. Here, then, the wretched man whose name he had now to learn lay underneath the ground. It was a worthy place, walled in by houses overrun by grass and weeds, the growth of vegetation's death, not life. The spirit stood among the graves and pointed down to one. "Before I draw nearer to that stone in which you point," said Scrooge, "answer me one question. Man's courses will foreshadow certain ends to which, if persevered in, they must lead," said Scrooge. "But if the courses be departed from, the ends will change. Are these the shadows of things that will be, or are they the shadows of things that may be only?" The spirit was immovable as ever. Scrooge crept towards it, trembling as he went, and following the finger, read upon the stone of the neglected grave the name. Ebenezer Scrooge. "Am I that man who lay upon the bed?" he cried upon his knees. The finger pointed from the grave to him and back again. "No, spirit. Oh, no, no." The finger still was there. "Spirit," he cried, right clutching at his robe, "hear me. I am not the man I was. I will not be the man I must have been before this intercourse. Why show me this if I am past all hope? Good spirit," he pursued as dawn upon the ground fell before it, "your kind nature intercedes for me and pities me. Assure me that I may yet change these shadows you have shown me by an altered life." The spirit's hand trembled. "I will honour Christmas in my heart and keep it all the year. I will live in the past, the present, and the future. The spirits of all three shall thrive within me. Oh, tell me that I may sponge away the writing on this stone." In his agony, he caught the spectral hand. It sought to free itself, but he was strong in its entreaty and detained it. The spirit, stronger yet, repulsed him. Holding up his hand in one last prayer to have his fate reversed, he saw as an alteration to the phantom's hood and dress. It shrank, collapsed, and dwindled down into a bedpost. Yes, the bedpost was his own. The bed was his own, and the room was his own. Best and happiest of all, the time before him was his own to make amends in. "I will live in the past, the present, and the future," Scrooge repeated, and he scrambled out of bed. "The spirits of all three shall thrive within me. Oh, Jacob Marley, heaven and the Christmas time be praised for this. I say it on my knees, old Jacob, on my knees." He had been sobbing violently in his conflict of the spirit, and his face was wet with tears. Returning to the window, he opened it, put out his hand. No fog, no mist. Clear, bright, jovial, stirring cold, golden sunlight, heavenly sky, sweet fresh air, merry bells. Oh, glorious, glorious! "What's today?" cried Scrooge, calling downward to a boy in Sunday clothes. "What's today, my fine fellow?" "Today," replied the boy. "Why, it's Christmas Day." "It's Christmas Day," said Scrooge to himself. "I haven't missed it. The spirits have done it all in one night. Hello, my fine fellow." "Hello," returned the boy. "Do you know the Poulterers in the next street but one at the corner?" Scrooge inquired. "I should hope I did," replied the lad. "An intelligent boy," said Scrooge, "a remarkable boy. Do you know whether they sold the prize turkey that was hanging there? The big one?" "What, the one as big as me?" returned the boy.
"What a delightful boy," said Scrooge. "It's a pleasure to talk to him. Yes, my buck."
"It's hanging there now," replied the boy.
"Go and buy it," said Scrooge, "and tell them to bring it here, that I may give them the direction where to take it. Come back with the man, and I'll give you a shilling. Come back with him in less than 5 minutes, and I'll give you half a crown." The boy was off like a shot.
"I'll send it to Bob Cratchit," whispered Scrooge,
rubbing his hands and spitting with a laugh. He shan't know who sends it. It's twice the size of Tiny Tim. He went downstairs to open the street door, ready for the coming of the poulterer's man. Here's the turkey. Hello again. Merry Christmas. The chuckle with which he recompensed the boy was only to be exceeded by the chuckle with which he sat down breathless in his chair again and chuckled till he cried. He dressed himself in all his best and at last got up to the streets. The people were by this time pouring forth. Scrooge regarded everyone with a delighted smile. He looked so irresistibly pleasant that three or four good-humoured fellows said, "Good morning, sir. A Merry Christmas to you." And Scrooge said often afterwards that of all the blithe sounds he had ever heard, those were the blithest in all his years. He had not gone far when, coming on towards him, he beheld the portly gentleman who had walked into his counting-house the day before and said, "Scrooge and Marley's, I believe." "My dear sir," said Scrooge, and taking the old gentleman by both his hands, "Mr. Scrooge?" "Yes," said Scrooge. "That is my name, and I fear it may not be pleasant to you. Allow me to ask your pardon. And will you have the goodness?" Here Scrooge whispered in his ear. "My dear sir," said the other, shaking hands with him, "I don't know what to say to such a "Don't say anything, please," retorted Scrooge. "Come and see me. Will you come and see me?" "I will," cried the old gentleman. "Thank you," said Scrooge. "I am much obliged to you." He went to church and walked about the streets and watched people hurrying to and fro and patted children on the head and questioned beggars and found that everything could yield him pleasure. He had never dreamed that any walk, that anything, could give him so much happiness. In the afternoon, he turned his step towards his nephew's house. He passed the door a dozen times before he had the courage to go up and knock. But he made a dash and did it. "Is your master at home, my dear?" said Scrooge to the girl. "Nice girl. Very." "Yes, sir. He's in the dining room, sir. I'll show you upstairs, if you please." "Thank you again. He knows me," said Scrooge, with his hand already on the dining room lock. "I'll go in here, my dear." He turned it gently and sidled his face in round the door. They were looking at the table, which was spread out in great array. "Fred," said Scrooge. "Why, bless my soul," said Fred. "Who's that?" "It's I, your Uncle Scrooge. I've come to dinner. Will you let me in, Fred?" "Let him in? It is a mercy he didn't shake his arm off. He was at home in 5 minutes. Nothing could be heartier. Everyone came. Wonderful party, wonderful games, wonderful happiness." But he was early at the office next morning. If he could only be there first and catch Bob Cratchit coming late. That was the thing he had set his heart upon, and he did it. Bob was a full 18 minutes and a half behind his time. "Hallo," growled Scrooge in his accustomed voice, as near as he could feign it. "What do you mean by coming here at this time of day?"
"It's only once a year, sir," pleaded Bob. "It shall not be repeated. I was making rather merry yesterday, sir."
"Now, I'll tell you what, my friend," said Scrooge. "I am not going to stand this sort of thing any longer, and therefore," he continued, leaping from his stool and giving Bob such a dig in the waistcoat that he staggered back into the door again, "and therefore, I am about to raise your salary." Bob trembled and got almost out of the door. He had a momentary idea of calling to the people in the court for help and a strait waistcoat. "A Merry Christmas, Bob," said Scrooge, with an earnestness that could not be mistaken, as he clasped him on the back. "A merrier Christmas, Bob, my good fellow, than I have given you for many a year. Make up the fire and buy another coal scuttle before you dot another I, Bob Cratchit." Scrooge was better than his word, and to Tiny Tim, who did not die, he became as good a friend and as good a man as the good old city knew. Some people laughed at the alteration in him, but he little heeded them, for he was wise enough to know that nothing ever happened on this globe for good at which some people did not have the full of laughter in the outset. His own heart laughed. That was quite enough for him. He had no further intercourse with spirits, and it was always said of him that he knew how to keep Christmas well.
May that be truly said of all of us. And so, as Tiny Tim observed, God bless us, everyone.
This is DJ Ashton Marcus, and we've just heard Rosemary Brownlow reading from A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens. She's a third-year MFA actor from Portland, Oregon. Welcome to the show. So tell me a little bit about yourself. Why acting, and how did you get to UCI?
Well, I am from Portland, Oregon, as you said. I went to college in Whitman College in Walla Walla, Washington, and I studied theater there. I think I got into acting because, actually, before Portland, I grew up in New York. I lived in New York till I was 8 years old, and I would go see Broadway shows. You know, we'd go see Peter Pan on Broadway and Beauty and the Beast on Broadway, and I sort of fell in love with it. I was always a big reader, and I think I fell in love with characters and stories that way. And, you know, historical time periods that we get to explore. That's one of the funnest parts about being an actor is you get to learn all about, you know, living in Dickensian England or living on Mars, for example, you know. You get to learn about different worlds and cultures. So I got to UCI. There's a rigorous audition process. And I decided, you know, I really wanted to get my MFA in acting. And I auditioned twice, and I got in the second time. And I'm so happy to be here.
Tell me about your relationship with A Christmas Carol.
I have actually been in A Christmas Carol twice. So it's a story that I love. And, you know, I grew up watching Mr. Magoo's Christmas Carol. That was our Christmas Carol of choice. As a kid, I would watch it every year. And the first time I was in it was at Northwest Children's Theater in Portland, Oregon. I was 16 years old. And it was my first professional job ever. And I played a Fezziwig daughter and a lady shopper and a party guest at Fred's party. So I had a very small part. But, you know, that was my first time. And then my second time was just last year in the season at UCI. We did A Christmas Carol directed by Annie Louie. And I played Jacob Marley and the Ghost of Christmas Future and Martha Cratchit and, oh, gee, I played one other part I know. Okay, those are my big ones. Martha Cratchit, The Ghost of Christmas Future, Jacob Marley. So it was a small cast, and we all played a bunch of different parts, and it was a very, very different production than the first time we played it.
Why do you think A Christmas Carol remains so popular at regional theaters throughout the country?
You know, I really think it's because it's a message that is so important nowadays in our culture of corporate greed and, you know, politics being taken over by money. And even living in the OC where people are rich and selfish, and I think we live in, since Reagan, a country that really celebrates being rich and being selfish and neglecting the poor and not caring about anyone other than yourself and not caring about poor people if you can't see them and sort of pretending that poor people aren't really people if you can see them. And so I think it's sadly, not much has changed since Dickensian England, and I think that it's a story that is very, very important. It has a clear social message, and it has a heart. And I think it's a story we have to keep telling ourselves until we can believe it as a society.
What are some of your favorite theater experiences at UCI?
Well, I've been fortunate enough to play a lot of different roles. Last year, I played Rosalind in As You Like It, and that was a ton of fun. And last summer at the New Swan Shakespeare Festival, I played Viola in Twelfth Night. In addition to Christmas Carol, I played the teacher in The Visit. I played Petra Quince in A Midsummer Night's Dream 2 years ago at the New Swan Shakespeare Festival. And I've done a number of independent projects that have been really fun, too.
So what's up next for you?
Well, next up at UCI, I am going to be in the Electra Project. I am the chorus leader. And then it's my last year here. We have a big showcase in April where we sort of show our stuff to agents in LA and New York. And then I am off to one of those cities to pursue a professional career.
Thank you very much for being on our show.
Thank you.